on time. So the idea is to present something we have been working in Bitergia during the last 6 months. Probably you already heard about Cauldron some time ago. We did some testing, but I would like to start with some story of, to justify this work we have been doing. So basically, I don't know how many of you know about GrimoireLab. If you don't know yet, you need to check it out. So basically, this is the open source tooling we started developing, I think, like 6 years ago, after 15 years of research about how to measure open source collaboration and stuff like that. We ended with this GrimoireLab thing, and then we released this as an open source project, and then when Chaos was created, it ended under the umbrella of the Linux Foundation, so it's not anymore a Bitergia project, it's a community-driven project. So basically, you are able to go there and play with it. And for us, the most challenging thing is basically it's managed by the user, so anyone willing to use it is basically you need to download it or clone the repository, start reading some kind of tutorial. Have you read the tutorial about GrimoireLab? Any feedback you want? Be fair, you can be fair about that, okay? So basically, you can use Docker, Docker Compose, and stuff like that. For me, the mind shift, the change was in San Diego. I decided to run a workshop about how to use GrimoireLab. It was one hour and a half workshop, and we spent the first hour with 5 people in the room trying to start the thing. Because there was one person that has not the right version of Docker. There was a person that was not even aware what Docker it is. There was, Tony, you were there. You remember the CTO of Bitergia sitting with you for 1 hour. Yes, okay, we got it running in the cloud environment from Google. Now, great. I can't talk about metrics if I need to spend 1 hour explaining how to start the tooling, right? It's not the way to do that. On the other side, we have Bitergia Analytics. Some people know, okay, these people are providing this as a service, so is this any different? No, it's not. It's actually GrimoireLab managed by Bitergia. That's cool. We are also adding consultancy, training, support, and all the cool stuff that you're expecting for a professional company. But of course, if you need to install this and play with it, you need to go through all the process of buying the thing, dealing with us, how are the data sources, how you configure the thing, again, how affiliate people to the right company, and all this stuff. So, it's like, okay, it's like a madness to get into the light. We are talking about metrics, how to make that easy for people. And for me, as the CEO of the company, I'm the less technical person. So I don't want to deal with how to write recipes to do Ansible. I know it's amazing. How to use Terraform. Nice name for a theme. I remember that Mars is going to be at some point. Oh, no, it's a tool for doing this kind of stuff. So is it possible at some point we start thinking, okay, is it possible to develop something that we can use fully managed by the user, like a SaaS environment, something that you can register and start playing with the tooling, of course with some kind of community and professional support so people can ask questions in a forum or whatever, and of course, like everything we do in software, it must be 100% free open source software, because we want free open source software being measured using a free open source software, right? I think it makes some sense. So this is how we ended with Cauldron. So Cauldron.io. Why Cauldron as a name? Okay, we are not very good at marketing. Now, thank you, Anna, we are improving a lot. We remember, we named the things Grimoire. You know, Grimoire is the book for recipes of wizards and magicians. So like, how we can name something that you can put all the ingredients, you put the recipes, that's the Cauldron. Oh, just call it Cauldron. So now I'm working in Bitergia, that we develop an open source tool called GrimoireLab, and another one that is called Cauldron. So if you can be able to remember the names, thank you. So basically, it's a 100% free open source software. So you can download it, even clone it, and install it in your machinery. But it's a SaaS solution also, so you can go to the website and play with it. And it's built on GrimoireLab, of course, Open Distro for ElasticSearch, very nice and cool open source project. As Django, we love Python, so we love Django. So that's it. And remember, it's still alpha. I expect that we are arriving to beta probably during next month, because I'm putting pressure on the team about that. We have things happening from time to time, but you know, that's how software works. If you know a perfect software, let me know, because it's hard to see. So how it works, this is for Matt. I remember, Matt, where are you? You told me if you are able to run this, just clicking a button, well. And it's a little bit trick. I don't want to deal with Wi-Fi, so basically you click on analyze a project. It's supporting already GitHub, GitLab, Git, Meetup even, so if you want to add these new data sources, you can do it. Let's analyze Cauldron, for example, the proper project, so we can dog food in it. You add there, And then automatically, it gathers all the repositories and the data organization for Git and GitLab issues and merge requests. And you can even see the logs of what's going on for each one of them. Boom, that it is ready. 20 seconds, I think, to get it running. Compared with 1 hour to get it running, right? I think that makes a difference at some point. Let's see if I can click on next slide. Okay. So basically, I have some screenshots even as backup. I love backups. So in one of the screens, you see there are one important link. One of them is this share report link. The idea of we are creating a dashboard that people are able to share with others with some basic numbers. We created this one. Of course, we can create a new one for just using chaos metric, but there are some metrics related with code activity, what are the maintainers and contributors to the project, the diversity of organizations, I mean the diversity of email domains, because we are planning not to store any private information from the contributors, only the email domain to avoid any kind of privacy issues, and of course activity about GitHub or GitLab issues and pull requests. So that's the public dashboard, but we have more. There was a button that was the workspace. What does the workspace does? It opens for you a full Kibana instance to run your own analysis. So you enter into a, now you're entering a, let's say, public part. So basically here is the same, you are not allowed to read you're not allowed to write there. So basically it's to provide this public dashboard, but you have your private thing where you can write even things like, for example, in this demo that, if you see it slow, probably you can blame my hotel Wi-Fi. This is what I've been using yesterday to prepare the slides and the demo. So let's create a simple visualization. And you have all these visualizations, right? Heat maps, tag clouds, line charts, pie charts, if you log them too. So let's create, for example, the number of, I think it's the authors used here. So let's unit count. And you have all these fields. These fields are documented in a forum we have set up for the community. So you can go there and see which fields do I have to play with the data. In this case, we are using the unique ID. That's basically the house code we are using to identify people in the community. We create a visualization that says, okay, during the last 6 months, there have been six identities working on this project. And I know a little couple of them are here. Sergio is over there, and JJ, where are you, JJ? Thank you very much for the work you have been done. It's awesome. These are the collections of data, these indexes that are produced, the collection of data we are storing for this. And you are creating a new visualization, for example, the evolution over time of active authors. So then we are going to, again, use the author UID, what you have seen out of the data we are using. You can use, for example, historical data for, I don't know, many seconds, probably let's do by month. Boom, it's there. This is how long it takes to provide a quite simple visualizations. And now the demo goes directly to, let's create a dashboard. How long does it take to create a dashboard I can reuse for reporting or to check what's going on my project? So basically you have there the visualizations. I think this is more easy than just playing with it, but you can do it now. You can go to Cauldron.io and break it. So I can build the dashboard, and there it is. But you can arrange things. I'm not very good at designing things, so I'm pretty sure that you are able to build things much better than me. I'm gonna stop it here and move to the next one, because we are limited on time. I'm giving a name to the dashboard. We are coming back to that later. So basically, with that, you have all the power. Some simple features you can see is basically it's all in one solution. In one website, you can build as many dashboards or projects you want. You can analyze several projects based on different data sources. We can also share, and this is one of the requests for the team, the idea is people even developing their own dashboard should be able to make that public to share all transparency of the project, or even if you are an analyst and you want to do some kind of, let's analyze the cloud environment. I can do that with Cauldron, and I build this visualization using even Markdown, and I can write a nice report that I can share with the people, stuff like that. Of course, it's going to be privacy by design. We are not going to store any data about the users, but we are not even store data about the. We are going to anonymize the data of the contributors. In this GDPR world that we are living now, even public data is under discussion of is public or not. Things like your email that's in Git is already public or not. And there are upcoming features that we'd like to let you know, areas we would like to improve. First of all, scalability. And I want to be fair on this. We don't have any clue about Kubernetes. But people tell us, you should be using Kubernetes. OK, I don't have any clue. So if any one of you are in the room and think, no, you should be using Kubernetes this way, we are more than welcome to listen to you. We have our scheduler that provides workers to do all this stuff in parallel. We would like to add a new data sources. We are missing the communication channels, and we recognize that they are very important. There is a tweet now, I think, running around in Cauldron, that is our Twitter, Bitergia probably, about which one would you like to see? Mailman, Groups.io, Slack, Discord. I love Discord. So I will vote for Discord. And what about the attribution management system? One of the differences that in Bitergia we are providing is this tool called Sorting Hat that is able to allow you to, first of all, merge the identity across the people, across the different data sources, also to add information like, okay, this person is working in this organization from this time, is from this country, or has this gender, for example. How to manage that in a proper way according to the law? Okay, we are working at Sorting Hat 2.0. I would recommend not to miss Miguel Angel's talk in Python's dev room about how we are now adding GraphQL support. And of course, new ways to do that in, I would like to discuss most of all this. And of course, sustainability of the project. Those folks are amazing. And as a CEO, I need to pay them for the work they are doing. So we are thinking about how to monetize this thing or support the project in a way that okay, it makes sense for people. And there are two options for this. Like for example, if you want more additional computational resources, for example, to speed up analysis and stuff like that, pay for that. Or for example, if you want to install this on-prem and have some kind of provisional setup, deployment and support, go for it. We start working on this in June, and I think it was after summer. People from Red Hat say, I want this in my company. And it's there, it's our early adopter. Thank you, Brian, for joining on this.
So you even did the hand waving right.
So that was amazing. So join our community. There is a GitLab repository with all the code and all the things to play with it. There is a Discord forum to ask for questions, support. There is Cauldronio, 20 live tweeting about what's going on in Cauldron. And of course, we have a newsletter. Marketing always loves newsletters, so please join the newsletter too. And remember, it's still alpha. Please remember that. And one more thing. I have a minute for this. For the lazy ones. I love to create dashboards, but I'm not very good at that. So imagine a situation that I design a dashboard, like this one, and I want to search with someone the designing of the dashboard. So basically, you can go there, click export, and the JSON file that defines the dashboard is automatically downloaded to your laptop. And you can do very simple things, like put that in a repository that people can start cloning it and use that in their own facilities. On their own account. So what I have created this morning, before breakfast, was chaos metrics dashboard for Cauldron. So basically, half of the metrics defining in the current release of chaos are supported by Cauldron. That was it. Let's go for questions. What do you think?
Can you go back one slide and also take a picture?
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, yeah. I am in GitLab. I love GitLab for this.
Thank you.
Questions, comments? I think we have 1 minute at least. 3 minutes, wow, on time. Yes.
Just with a view on inner source, is it possible to configure Cauldron to be able to access private Git repositories?
Well, actually, it's one of the use cases that we are using with the people in Red Hat, they are analyzing internal repositories. It's a matter of how you configure the thing. I would recommend wait for it. If you want to try this, of course, it's available. You can read the configuration files and then check how what needs to be changed. But that's the idea in the long term for the project is basically you can use publicly as a SaaS solution and also on-prem for inner sourcing, of course, at some point. Matt?
So the metrics, the thing that you have right there, which metrics did you, I'm curious which ones you have up there. It's a sample.
Yeah, there is the common metrics about activities per day and hour of the day. The ones we did with a number average to an average and media to first response. The ones related with the number of contributors, maintainers, contributors, users, and observers, in this case, because we are also analyzing observers from the point of view of people that are coming to meetups. Users, the people that are opening issues in GitHub or GitLab or asking questions in the future in the mailing list or whatever. Contributors, the people that are submitting issues or, no, sorry, the people that are answering issues or answering to questions or even submitting code for pull requests. Or merge request, and maintainers, the people that are actually writing code with permission into the mainstream. The diversity, organizational diversity, in this case, based only on the domain of email domains. The evolution of number of lines of code and number of commits. The accepted code reviews. The average to, I don't remember this one by memory. Issues and pull requests by state, active ones. The current active issues for the last month, if I remember well, these are from the evolution, the last ones. You know better than me the chaos metrics, right? I need to remember all of them, even not going to all the calls.
Yeah, most of them. That's great, thank you.
Yeah, okay. Do you have time for any more?
Last one?
Last one question, comment? I want my hack. Matt, you promise a hack if I can do this in a click. So, that was it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.